Under the life-giving light and warmth of a distant K-type main sequence star, a faraway planet teems with vegetation. The yellow leaves of these tree cognates, colored by the carotenoids that are their main energy-absorbing pigment, glisten with dewdrops as the first hints of golden beams of light begin to break over the horizon. Slowly but noticeably, those leaves begin to turn towards the light, and as the first rays hit them, a soft but steady keening can be heard. The source of this sound, a soothing thrum mixed with clicks and chirps, comes from a small army of awakening cricket-like arthropod cognates. These small insectile aliens emerge from openings in the stems of the plants. Much like Earth's whistling thorn acacia, these trees have evolved in symbiosis with the cricket beasts. Their stems are hollow and form nesting habitats for their insect allies. At certain times of the day, the plants excrete nectars to feed their guardians. The eusocial hoppers prove themselves to be formidable soldiers, attacking any pest that would eat the plants and discarding their bodies near the roots of the plant to nourish their host. But there appears to be something else behind the crickets' non-random movements. They seem to have a guiding purpose behind where they go and what duties they perform. At certain times during the day, the nectar excreted by the plant changes viscosity and hue, its chemical composition altered by the addition and subtraction of chemical pheromones. The insects respond to their new set of instructions and march across the grove to an older, withering tree. They begin tearing off its leaves one by one in a surprisingly gentle but purposeful manner. Infected by a xenofungus, this plant will not survive, but by removing its leaves and taking them far away from the rest of the grove, the other trees will be spared a similar fate. That night, the cricket chirps sound almost mournful, and strange bioluminescent flashes can be seen flickering around the grove. It almost looks like a semaphore display, and slowly, whatever information it conveys spreads from its point of origin around the old dying tree outwards throughout the grove. A beloved elder is finally succumbing to disease after many centuries under a bright orange sun, and they are passing on their accumulated knowledge to the next generation. In Stellaris, plantoids refer to roughly humanoid-shaped aliens with plant-like features. Plantoids were added to Stellaris in an art DLC, and although they introduced no new mechanics, they do make for a lively way to add additional opportunities for roleplay to your space empires. But is it possible for a plant to become sapient, or even develop the technology needed to reach the stars? Could we one day come across a plantoid civilization on some distant star? Though it is difficult to perceive in action, the plants that live all around you are indeed sentient beings. To be sentient simply means they can perceive and respond to external stimuli. Even a bacterium has a form of sentience, in that bacteria can move towards or away from chemical signals in their environment. Plants certainly do this. All photosynthetic plants demonstrate tropism, the act of growing towards sunlight. Sometimes tropism can happen rapidly. Juvenile helianthus, sunflowers, famously align their flowers with the sun as it progresses across the sky and even reorient their disk during the night to face west to catch the rising sun. In addition to tropism, plant roots are sophisticated, problem-solving, and sensate organs. They must discover sources of food and nourishment and invest growth in claiming those resources, a demonstration of problem-solving skills in plants. Some plants go further than mere tropism and can rapidly respond to mechanical stimuli, such as the severing of leaves by a predator. Mimosa pudica, we call them touch-me-nots where I live, will rapidly tuck their leaves into their stems in response to a grazer or a very rude human pulling off some of their leaves, a distinct defensive adaptation meant to protect them from hungry ungulates and other browsers. At night, they also use this mechanism to conserve water. Folding the leaves means less water is lost to evaporation. Dionaea muscipula, or Venus flytraps, are the ultimate example of plants exhibiting sensation followed by response, both in terms of speed, as well as the general level of complexity demonstrated by their sophisticated trap mechanisms. Let's consider the biology of the Venus flytrap, because it demonstrates that plants have another key aspect of potential sapience. Sapience, from the Greek word for wisdom, implies self-awareness, imagination, and other trappings of what we would call intelligence. That key is memory. Without the ability to store and further process information, sapience is not possible. The Venus flytrap relies on sensitive, tactile hairs to trigger its trap mechanism. But because the movement of the trap is energy intensive, flytraps have evolved to respond to trigger stimuli only if whatever triggered the hairs is indeed a prey animal. A single raindrop or windblown detritus touching the flytrap is not enough stimuli to trigger the trap. Instead, the trap will only fire if trigger hairs detect movement, and multiple hairs must be triggered in rapid succession before a firing will occur. This means that a Venus flytrap must remember whether or not an individual trigger hair has been triggered within a certain temporal threshold. Compare that event with any others that might have occurred on its other trigger hairs, then decide whether or not the trigger hairs are detecting a beetle or grasshopper, or if they were triggered by, say, a bit of dust blown in by the wind. Once triggered, specialized cells in the trap rapidly secrete ions. Whether these are hydrogen ions or other elements like calcium or a combination of both is not yet known from these cells, creating an action potential. Action potentials are a bit like a chemical version of pushing a boulder up a cliff, only to let it roll down again. By using their metabolism to artificially move these ions through their cell membranes, the flytrap creates an unbalanced system. And once that disequilibrium becomes strong enough, there's a natural tendency for fluids, in this case water, to rapidly rush back into the cell. We call this process osmosis. And if it happens quickly enough and across enough of the flytrap cells, it can create rapid movement throughout the leaf. The fact that flytraps rely on action potentials, especially ones that only work if there is intracellular communication between sensate organs, is doubly interesting because a similar system exists in animals. Neurons utilize sodium and potassium ion channels to generate action potentials that are the source of nerve impulses. Through convergent evolution, the flytrap has created its own version of the nervous system. And where there's a nervous system, there is the potential for a mind. Plants have also demonstrated in a lab setting and in their natural environment, experiential learning, the ability to alter future behaviors based on past experiences. Parasitic dodder, a plant species that latches onto the roots of other plants to absorb their nutrients, will hunt and seek out hosts that are healthy and more nutritious. They do so by detecting volatile compounds released by their prey, in effect hunting by smell. And older specimens of parasitic dodder are faster at choosing a new host than young dodder plants. Many plants also develop immunological memory. Radishes, as an example, will produce more defensive chemicals and trichomes, with small defensive hairs on their leaves, after a second attack by caterpillars. The mechanism behind such abilities is likely a chemical form of memory based on phytohormones, which can act as epigenetic triggers to alter what genes are expressed by the plant. But being sensate and having some form of memory and decision-making abilities does not make a sapient being, nor does it lead to civilization. For that, you need communication. Information must be collectively shared and passed on across generations. Some form of language is likely essential for technological development and abstract thought. One theory behind why it took modern humans nearly 200,000 years to go from basic stone tools and building campfires to suddenly undergoing the Neolithic Revolution and then in less than 10,000 years leaping from pottery and the wheel to splitting the atom is that language itself was simply too primitive before 10,000 years ago for humans to create and invent like they do today. A plantoid civilization would need a mechanism for sharing ideas across individuals. Elders would need to teach the young. Some plants already do so. One form of plant communication relies on chemical cues. Most plants, when damaged, say by an herbivore stripping its leaves, will release volatiles. These airborne chemicals can be detected by its neighbors, and those neighbors will alter their behaviors in response to this new threat, producing bitter-tasting compounds, increasing production of physical defenses like thorns and trichomes, and slowing or increasing their growth, to name a few. Plants even use these chemical signals to enlist the aid of helpful insects. Some plant species will produce chemicals to track wasps when they become infested by caterpillars. This mutualism can be quite advanced, with plant species being able to distinguish between different species of caterpillar and producing chemicals to attract just the right kind of wasp need to deal with the infestation. And plants can and do utilize chemical cues to teach their offspring. Returning to the earlier example of radishes, radish mothers that have been attacked by caterpillars pass on that information to their seeds, which will produce the defense response against caterpillars, even if they themselves have not been attacked. Cues can be visual as well as chemical in nature. Plant flowers, when viewed in the ultraviolet frequencies, change their appearance throughout the day to best guide pollinators to their pistils. This hints at another possible way for plant communication to occur, bioluminescence. Plants already can sense light. Tropism is a vital capability for a photosynthetic organism. And though they are not plants, bioluminescence fungi demonstrate a chemical mechanism by which an alien plant might produce its own light at night. It stands to reason that if plants were put under the right environmental conditions, they might evolve a means to communicate more rapidly than with simple chemical cues, using bioluminescence to send light-based signals to each other. Such a species would begin to benefit more and more from mutual cooperation amongst its members, and the sophistication of the semaphore-like language would increase with each generation, along with their ability to form epigenetic memories in an ever more complex web of action potentials. These social plants would be well on their way towards true sapience, perhaps even technological civilization. Plantoids made real.